Hi everyone, my name is Kent and welcome to my shop. Today we'll be replacing this R8 drawbar from a PM25 milling machine with one that's easier to torque properly. So let's get started. The standard drawbar on the PM25 milling machine has an inconvenient 8mm square head. The head is 8mm to fit through a cup which screws onto the top of the quill. And this cup may be there to help eject the collet as the drawbar is loosened. But to eject the collet requires several turns of the drawbar. To tighten the drawbar, an 8mm wrench is too short. And I've been using an adjustable wrench, and it works fine. It's about the right length, but this 8mm head just feels like I'm going to strip it off with the adjustable wrench. An 8.5/16 inch socket works well, and if you had a long ratchet, this might work fine. The socket has to be 8 point though, a 6 point and 12 point socket will not work. You can also put the socket onto an adapter and mount it into a cordless driver and have a sort of power drawbar if you like. We're going to replace the drawbar with one turned from 7/8 inch 1045 steel. McMaster indicates that 1045 is a good choice for bolts, so it made sense to select it for a drawbar. We'll use most of the dimensions of the standard PM25 drawbar, but we'll increase the size of the head to a standard 3/4 inch hex. These changes are to ensure proper torque on the drawbar and to ensure that the Tormach TTS collet is able to retain tooling under heavy load. In a subsequent video, we'll make a wrench for our new drawbar.
The first operations are on the lathe. We're facing the end of the rod to prepare it to be center drilled. The tool that we're using here is from Aloris. It's a carbide insert tool. I'm just center drilling the end of the stock. This is a live center from Royal, and it's a CNC model which has an extended tip and allows you to get tools in where a regular live center you may have interference. This line will be a reference that we'll cut to. So first pass. I've had a lot of success with this carbide tool in both aluminum and steel, but this is the first time that I've machined 1045. It was challenging to get a good surface finish. Normally I don't use any cutting oil to avoid the smoke in my basement shop. The first pass was done dry. After trying various speeds and feeds without a great deal of success, I brought the fog buster over from the mill. The coolant certainly helped to keep the part cooler, but the surface finish still wasn't great. As a last resort, I broke down and tried cutting oil, which created a lot of smoke, especially with the carbide tool. A high-speed steel insert tool seemed to cut better than the carbide tool did. I think the part was work hardening while turning, and the coolant and the cutting oil helped, but it just wasn't enough. And it was possible to actually see this happening as I was cutting with the carbide tool. The material would come shiny and resistant to cutting, and the best I could come up with is just to push the tool harder and get underneath that hardened surface and continue cutting. The carbide tool has a large radius, and the high-speed steel tool has a small radius. And I was using roughly the same depth to cut for both, and I think this is a mistake. As the nose radius of the tool increases, the depth of the cut should also increase. The settings that seemed to work the best was 700 RPM at 20,000 depth of cut with the high-speed steel tool with cutting oil. As I said before, I'd really like to avoid cutting oil, and I think it would be possible to do with coolant. Of course, the coolant has its own problems, in particular the rust that I've seen on the mill. To avoid the rust, you just have to dry everything off well, blow it off with air, and apply some oil to the surfaces. Definitely some more experimentation is in order. For the purpose of this part, the surface finish was certainly acceptable. I'm just trying to clean it up a little bit with a file. During experimenting with the CNC conversion on the lathe, I removed the Acme lead screw. And the Acme lead screw was necessary in order to do threading. So right now I don't have threading capability on the lathe. For threading, I'm using a die which is held on a holder which is then held in the drill chuck and the tailstock. The tailstock isn't secure and it's able to move, and as we turn the chuck, the workpiece starts to thread into the die, pulling the tailstock along. To turn the chuck, I'm inserting the key and pulling the key and the chuck toward me. The bore of the die holder is too small to allow the drawbar to go through it. We finish the threading using a handheld die holder. The chuck is secured in place by inserting the key and allowing the key to press into the bed. It may look like a lot of work is being done to thread, but actually the metal cut nicely. Now the key is swapped to the other side to hold the chuck in place as we spin the die off. The excess material being held by the collet was taken to a saw and cut off, and then the cut was cleaned up with a facing pass on the lathe. The flats for the hex head still have to be cut, but we can add their chamfer now. At the CNC mill, we'll cut the hex head flats. As with any operation, we have to first define our origin. To find the edge of this round stock, we make a guess where the center line is, and then run the Heimer up and down, testing for deflection. The highest point over that travel is where we'll touch off the edge. After touching off our y-axis, we repeat this process for our z-axis. Moving the Heimer the length of the stock helps to identify if the stock is parallel to the table. Touching off the x-axis is easy. Making use of the tools that are available, we use Fusion 360 to produce the G-code to cut the flats. In Fusion 360, we're using the adaptive 2D milling strategy. We only create a program for one flat. Since the part is held in a 5C collet indexer, we'll rotate the part 60 degrees and rerun the program for each of the flats. It's debatable if CNC helps in this instance. This operation may actually be faster if done on a manual mill, at least when compared against unoptimized G-code. After the experience of cutting 1045 steel on the lathe and possibly have it work hardening, the coolant flow on the mill is pretty generous to keep the steel cool. The collets didn't close properly in the indexer. A 3164th collet should have closed onto the shaft perfectly, but the indexer simply wouldn't compress the collet enough. I'll look into this more. I may be using the indexer wrong, or there may be a design problem. This is a generic import high-speed steel 4-flute end mill. The spindle is rotating at 1000 RPM and we're cutting roughly 25 surface feet per minute. I'll speed the video up to get to the next interesting section. The full depth of cut is taken, and I think the end feed was 25 thousandths. From another view, we can see the normal milling marks. The surface finish is fine though. The part is cool, almost cold, especially compared to how hot it was on the lathe. After a quick adjustment of the indexer, the program is rerun to cut the next flap. The collets used by this indexer are the same 5C collets that I used on the lathe. This indexer has been really handy, and I've used it several times, always the same purpose, to make flats on shavs. I'm sure that someday I'll make a fourth axis for the mill, but for the time being, this collet indexer is doing everything that I need it to. The program in Fusion 360 was set for 10 inches per minute, or about 130 surface feet per minute. And with any new program, I tend to start the feed override at 20% and slowly increase it. By this point, I had increased it to 80%, or 104 surface feet per minute. We'll play this section again in slow motion and watch how everything flexes as the end mill moves around the apex of the corner. Did you see it? The feed rate is still the same that it was, but that noise certainly got my attention. And there it is again, possibly more severe this time. Let's take a look at that in slow motion. For a hobby machinist like me, it's more important that parts get machined properly than that they are machined at the fastest possible rate. Starting a part over is a painful loss of time. I'd rather run the machines conservatively and have a part come off right the first time than have to repeat a part. I backed the feed override rate down to 50% and didn't have any problems after. 50% on the speed override equates to 65 surface feet per minute. The little machine shop has a great cutting reference that says for milling 1045 steel, 25 to 100 surface feet per minute should be used. At 80%, I was exceeding that at 104 surface feet per minute. At 50%, I'm right in the middle at 65 surface feet per minute. And the moment of truth, the socket does fit, but it's a little bit loose. I measure across the flats with a caliper and find the distance is 20 thousandths under what I expected. I wish I was closer to my target size, but this error won't cause a problem. After more experience machining steel, I'll redo this part and do a better job the next time.
And now we remove the old drawbar one last time. We will not be using this cup any longer. Just loosen the drawbar and remove the collet. Pull the drawbar out. And in with our new drawbar. It's a lot easier to spin this one by hand. Yeah, that's going to be really nice. I hope you found this video interesting. There's going to be two additional ones coming soon. One is on construction of a drawbar wrench, and the other is on the necessity of properly torquing the drawbar. Comments and suggestions are always welcome. I hope you come back for the next video. Until then, thank you for watching.